Thank you. When the sound comes on, can you hear me in the last row? Thank you. Last row, Chrissy can hear me. We're on. So welcome, welcome, welcome on this almost snowy Sunday. Great. My name is Chris George, and I use she, her pronouns. I serve as one of your board of trustee members, and I'm happy to welcome you to Tahoma Unitarian Universalist Congregation. Longtime members and new visitors alike, you are welcome here. Whether you are joining us here on site in the sanctuary or online from another location, we're glad you're here. We are one people of many beliefs, many origins, sexualities, and genders. And love is the power that holds us together. We are all growing, all learning, all loved. You are welcome just as you are. If this is your first time with us, I bid you a special welcome. I am so glad you found your way to our community. After the service, I will be in the back of the sanctuary right over there to answer any questions you may have about Unitarian Universalism, about our congregation, or if you want to talk about how to get involved in our community. Please feel free to join me back there after the service. Also, I'm asking all board members who are here today to please stand. I want you to feel free to approach any of us with questions. Doug, Stacy, Chrissy, Maria. Good. That's right. I knew I'd seen Dolores. Dolores is here too. She's being the welcome out front. Yes. Yes. Thank you. For those of you here in the sanctuary, we have hearing assistance devices and large print hymnals available in the back of the sanctuary on that table. Come on in. For our service this morning, our online chat chaplain will help guide our online folks. And for those of us on site, we will be utilizing the screen behind me to project the words for our unison readings and lyrics for our hymns. You can also follow along with the printed order of service, which was on the table outside when you came in. Also on the order of service, you see a QR code in the lower right-hand corner that will take you to our weekly e-news. If you aren't signed up for the e-news, you can do that today so that you don't miss a thing. Do you hear microphone? I think we're getting our microphone. There is so much happening here at Tahoma UU. I want to highlight just a few exciting announcements. We are planning a church auction on April 13th, and I'd like David Pettit, there he is, thought I lost him, to talk to us about that a little bit and about the third Friday potluck.
Good morning, everyone. My name is David Pettit, and I have worked with the auction committee or on the auction committee several times over the last 20, 25 years. It's a lot of fun. It's always good food and a lot of good conversation. And there are some pretty cool things in here to bid on. There are what we're going to do this year is have some silent auction items, you know, where you write down your bid number and your name and everything, and just kind of keep going until it's closed off and whoever the last bidder was gets to claim that gift. We're going to have some live auction items, everything from camping trips. I know Chris Kaufman has donated 2 1-week stays at his cabin up on the Sauk River, which is about 13 or 14 miles north of Darrington. And it's a beautiful little cabin, right on the river, easy access. It's a cool deal. I know there's going to be a camping trip donated, a lot of different items. Be watching your e-news coming up here pretty soon. There are going to be links. We have one up right now where you can go on to a website and list an item that you might be interested in donating. I'll be circulating, and some of you probably got the handout at the front door. The backside of that handout has some ideas of things that you might look at donating, that kind of things. We also have an online website where you can make your donation directly online. We have another website that's going to get put out in the e-news coming up here pretty soon, a link. This week's e-news will have a link to volunteer positions to make something like this happen. We need quite a handful of volunteers. We need people to help set up the chairs, set up the tables to take the auction donations in. We need people especially to help process those auction items after the auction is over with, you know, get each bidder's items organized, get the payments made and that kind of jazz. So be watching your e-news real carefully for that. There'll be more information. You can always talk to me. I'll be hanging around for a half an hour or 45 minutes after today's service. There's also TUUC auction 2024 at gmail.com. And again, that's going to, in the e-news. So long as I'm up here, I'm also going to make a plug for the upcoming Third Friday potluck, which is something we do every month on the third Friday of the month. It will not be this coming Friday, but that'll be the Friday following. Our guest speaker this time is Mike Slama, who is organizing a co-housing project out in the Puyallup Valley. And he's going to present some information. He's going to show a basic plan of the site. It's an old farm that's been down there, a raspberry farm that got sold. He bought it. And he's looking at good stewardship of the land in conjunction with the expanding housing, which is what the county wants to do with it. So putting those two things together and building a little community within a community. So if you have questions about the Third Friday potluck, again, see me after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, David. A lot going on. And I have one more fun opportunity to highlight. And that is working with our children in the RE rooms downstairs on Sunday mornings. Our policies require that we have two adults with each group of children. So one person will be guiding the learning and the discussion, and one will be keeping an eye on things. Can you be the one who watches and supports? Can you be the one who guides the learning? Either way, please reach out to Stacy Kopcha, who is coordinating our program this year. And I know she's here right there. Again, thank you, Stacy. Again, you can check out the e-news for more information about these and many more ways to become involved and deeply connected with our spiritual community. You are also invited to join us for social hour immediately following the service right here in the sanctuary. There will be coffee and refreshments, and it's a great time to catch up or get to know someone new. For those of you who are visiting or who are new to our community, we have red coffee mugs for you to use if you would like to identify yourself as new and want us to come up and chat with you. And now, returning to our pulpit, Reverend Jennifer DeBusk Alviar, who is leading our worship today. She is an ordained Unitarian Universalist minister whose unique call is to expand the welcome table of hospitality, inclusion, and liberation. To this end, she cultivates positive relationships with community organizations and diverse faith traditions, actively engaged in the healing work of bridge building and social change. In particular, she advocates for equity, accessibility, and inclusion for brain injury survivors and those who identify as neurodivergent. Reverend Jennifer received her Master of Divinity degree at Star King School for Ministry in Berkeley, California. She currently lives with her family on the indigenous land of the Duwamish people, known as Seattle, Washington. Lastly, friends, I invite you to set your electronic devices to worship mode. We are gathered here, one community together. Let us settle ourselves into this holy moment and open our hearts to learn and unlearn, to share and to receive. I respectfully acknowledge that I speak to you today from the occupied Puyallup and Coast Salish ancestral lands. I pay respect to elders past and present and extend that respect to their descendants and all Indigenous people. Now, let us join together in worship.
Thank you, Marianne. It's lovely. Well, I'm so grateful to be together with you again from last month. Thank you. I am, at introduction, Reverend Jennifer DeBusk Alviar. My pronouns are she, her. We gather as a caring community seeking life's deeper meanings. We value theological diversity. We affirm the worth and dignity of all gender expressions and abilities. We strive to speak truth in love, to act for justice, to grow in spirit, and to care for the earth. We celebrate with open hearts and minds the creative power that sustains and transforms us. It is a pleasure to join you for this sacred time of gathering. May you feel warmly welcomed. And come, let us worship together.
Good morning, my name. your service to this congregation. We're going to light our chalice now, at which point I now realize that I failed to ask someone to be our chalice lighter, and that's just a little detail. I wonder if I might call on a fellow board member. Maria, would you mind me putting you on the spot for that? Because of your brilliance. Not happening? Grab a light from that other candle over in the, there you go. Follow the light over the candles that are lit. That'll work. We're going to be creative today. Thank you so much, Maria. Appreciate that. And now, as our words come up on the screen, would you please join me in our chalice lighting words? We light this chalice in deep respect for the mystery and holiness of life, in honor and gratitude for those who have gone before, with love and compassion for those who dwell among us, and with hope and faith for the generations to come. Now we'll invite our young and young at heart to come up front for a time for all ages. Oh, this is what happens when we skip a line in the order of service. Thank you for keeping me honest here. Our opening hymn is number 108. My life flows on with endless song. If you'd like to rise in body or spirit and join in singing, the words will appear on the screen behind me. My life flows on. Our young and young at heart for a time for all ages up front with Reverend Alviar.
your deck.
Oh, we're gonna lit up. Let's see. All right. How's that? All right. Good. All right. Well, welcome. It's one of my favorite parts of the service, the storytelling. So here is we're gonna be reading Outside In by Deborah Underwood and Cindy Derby. Can you see the pictures here? It's really it's a watercolor. And we're gonna talk about nature. You like nature? Yeah, me too. So once we were part of outside, and outside was part of us. There was nothing between us. So you can see. Mm-hmm. And that is it. That's our nature, our journey this morning. So I now invite you for the congregants to make an arch and sing our kids to.
We now move into our invitation to generosity, that section of our service where we reach out to get the funding we need to carry forward with our church. The purpose of the church is to encourage all who gather here to grow more generous in spirit and in action. This is the great end of all of the world's faith traditions, to bring the human being closer to the divine by acts of creation and compassion. We now take an offering that allows us to exercise that all-important generosity of spirit, an offering that will support this self-supporting church and its many ministries. The gifts of the congregation will most gratefully be received. Thank you so much.
Did you write that?
And now would you join me in dedicating this offering? We dedicate ourselves and our offerings to the work of this congregation, weaving a tapestry of love we call community, both within and beyond these walls. For our time of meditation, I'd like to have you enjoy listening to and watching performance of Ode to Joy by Ludwig von. Now take two. Now an excerpt from Sabbath by Wayne Mueller. There's a hum the earth makes when seasonal winds pass over waves and mountain all across the earth and sea. A sound is born, a low frequency pulsation, audible to migrating birds thousands of miles away. By listening to the music of the earth, birds find their way home. Many birds also possess an inner orientation to true north. When they fly at night, they use the patterns and movements of the stars to guide their flight. Even in a planetarium, with the night sky projected on the ceiling, birds fly in rhythm with the seasonal stars. Now our sermon, Navigating the Soul of Human Nature and the Natural World, Reverend Alviar.
I am on my way to Mexico for a sunny, relaxing winter vacation. As I board the bus with my fellow resort travelers, I notice an influx of instruments all around me. I spot a cello, a viola, and several violins. As luck would have it, my chosen vacation week at Rancho La Puerta happens to coincide with a lively chamber music festival for this time. Perfect. I will enjoy some classical music along with the sunshine. What I do not anticipate, however, is the prominent role that Beethoven would play in reshaping my theology as a Unitarian Universalist minister. In particular, the unique way in which music helps us become more attuned to the human nature and the natural world. This musical, nature-based theological connection unfolds through a series of whimsical twists and turns. I joined my fellow hikers early morning Tuesday to trek up a mountain for a breakfast concert hike. Along the way, my eyes take in a magnificent sunrise. As I gaze up at the hillside, I am surprised and delighted at the sight of a violinist playing melodic tune. Another violinist appears further up the mountain. It turns out that Monique Mead, the artistic director of this chamber music festival, has creatively woven in random acts of music as part of her interdisciplinary approach. And you experienced some of hers with the performing Beethoven that we had today. After arriving at the top of the mountain and enjoying a delicious breakfast, we are ushered into an intimate setting where the Miro Quartet begins its performance. I have never had the privilege of being so close up to a concert like this before, especially not one where we can be perfectly at ease enjoying exquisite music in our hiking boots. I am immediately drawn to the dynamic interplay between music and musicians. I notice how attentive each musician is to each other. They work seamlessly together in coordinating their time, the rhythm, the notes, breath, sound, and harmony. I do not have a background in music theory. As a minister, however, I am attentive to this particular theological challenge. Identifying the discordant notes of our human lives and exploring ways to create harmony in the midst of struggle. Following this sensory musical experience, I find myself trying to name what I felt that morning. And then it hits me. I have an aha moment. The word I'm looking for is attunement. Attunement embodies all the elements of harmony and human connection, but I'm struggling to integrate this musical experience within a larger theological context. So I decide to hold that thought for later. For now, I'm heading over to the Beethoven talk led by violist John Larges from the Miro Quartet in anticipation for this evening's concert. John begins by setting the context of Beethoven's early period. Beethoven is a famous pianist. He has a big ego. He is edgy, raw, defiant. During the classical period of the mid-18th, early 19th century, and into the romantic period of the 19th century and early 20th century, music was intended to be pleasant. Beethoven does not follow suit. Some people find his style off-putting. Other people find him captivating and cutting edge. During this early period, Beethoven is accepted into the Viennese aristocracy. Prominent people from the nobility class finance his financial artistic livelihood. Beethoven has it made. And right, at the height of his glory, Beethoven's world comes crashing down. This is known as Beethoven's middle period or heroic period. It marks a time of great adversity. His mentor, Haydn, dies. Napoleon invades Vienna. Beethoven proposes to his beloved. She denies him. His finances deteriorate. His brother dies, leading him into a lengthy court battle over his sister-in-law to secure custody of his nephew. In the midst of all of this, Beethoven becomes deaf. He withdraws from society and stops composing for several years. This kind of adversity, in theological terms, is often called the dark night of the soul. It is coined by the Spanish mystic John of the Cross. In Beethoven's case, he doesn't experience one or two dark nights of the soul. Instead, he encounters a dark artistic tangle of the soul. At the brink of despair, Beethoven contemplates suicide. Poised on the edge between life and death, Beethoven chooses life. Why? Here is how he expresses it in a letter to his brothers known as his Heiligenstadt Testament. I would have put an end to my life, only art it was that withheld me. Ah, it seemed impossible to leave the world until I had produced all that was called upon me to produce. Beethoven's words captivate me. I want to learn more. So the next day, on my morning ritual hike up the mountain, I have the good fortune of hiking with Monique, the chamber music artistic director. I say with some urgency, "Monique, I have to ask you something about Beethoven's character. Did Beethoven ever come to peace with his life? Did he find hope in the midst of struggle? Was he able to reconcile his human pain and suffering with grace and gratitude for his musical gifts?" Monique pauses and considers my questions. Then she says, "It's complicated." While Beethoven was always rough and ill-mannered on the outside, he maintained very high ideals and a love of humanity. He was moved by the German poet and philosopher Friedrich Schiller, who wrote Ode to Joy. This poem stated what his soul believed. Beethoven wanted art to uplift humanity. This is what inspired Beethoven to compose a musical rendition of Ode to Joy for his Ninth Symphony. Beethoven's personal challenges, in fact, enhanced his musical gifts. He learned to rely on his inner ear for artistic instinct and guidance. He shifted from being a great performer to being a great composer. In the end, music served as the container in which Beethoven experienced moments of grace. Moments of grace. Yes, human nature is complex, and Beethoven was no exception. Perhaps this is why it makes sense to take an interdisciplinary approach towards reflecting on the word attunement within the context of grace and atonement. When we find ourselves in grace-filled moments with nature, music, and beauty, like I experienced on my morning breakfast concert hike, our natural instinct is one of praise. We get outside ourselves. We move beyond our egos. In Monique's documentary, Beethoven in the Face of Adversity, she speaks of the indomitable human spirit that we have within us. This spirit that allows Beethoven to compose the violin concerto, even though he is deaf. That spirit that allows us to rise up and conquer the adversities we face every day. This spirit, this grace, this resilience are beautiful aspects of our human nature on a soul level. However, in order to access this soulful nature, we must also be willing to surrender and let go of our agendas and assume a posture of humility versus certitude. This is not easily done. Atonement, therefore, might be conceived as our resistance towards surrendering and facing the darker aspects within us. This, too, is part of our human nature. Quaker educator and activist Parker Palmer wisely expressed it in these words: violence is what happens when we don't know what else to do with our suffering. Our inability to bear our own pain leads us to commit a multitude of transgressions through the act of othering those on the margins. This includes racial inequities, gender inequities, religious intolerance, cultural genocide, and environmental degradation, to name just a few. To atone for our failings places us in a posture of humility. When we acknowledge our human fallibility and seek reconciliation, this can open us to moments of grace. But how exactly do we enter into this practice of atonement to move us towards attunement? The world's religions offer diverse spiritual disciplines, prayers, rituals, and sacraments to atone for our human shortcomings. Within the context of human nature and the natural world, I am drawn to the work of Bill Plotkin. He is an ecologist and wilderness guide with a background in depth psychology. Plotkin helps us understand the process of soul work by building upon Carl Jung's work on dreams, along with mythology and human development. In his book, Nature and the Human Soul, Plotkin describes the dark night of the soul as an opportunity to transform a core wound into a sacred wound. In Beethoven's case, his deafness represents his core wound. He loses access to the outer world of sound, leading to a crisis of identity. Yet when he relies on his inner ear, he composes exquisite works of music. In fact, it has been said that Beethoven rested his head on the piano to feel the music's vibrations when he couldn't hear the musical notes themselves. His deep attunement to his interior world of artistry transformed his core wound into a sacred wound. Music is Beethoven's window into grace. Consider your own life experiences. In a world that is commonly referred to as a veil of tears, how might you encounter with a core wound and transform it into a sacred wound? How might your reflection and understanding of suffering invite you into moments of grace? This invitation towards deeper soul making awaits each of us at every moment. It is now Friday morning, my last day of vacation. As part of Monique's continuation of random acts of music, she invites John Kimura Parker, also known as Jackie Parker, to play some peaceful piano music at the end of our meditation session. Jackie embodies a lighthearted ode to joy, spirit, and personality, and humor. I ask him, what practices do you find most helpful in keeping the musicians attuned to each other and their music? He laughs and says, well, we spend a lot of time tuning our instruments. But I guess you could say that we are all working together on creating a collective sense of at-one-ment with our music. I smile. I feel lit from within. This is my own ode to joy moment as a minister. This week-long musical and linguistic journey has enriched my understanding and appreciation of the word attunement in partnership with the word at-one-ment. Monique expresses it best in these words. Attunement is the ultimate act of awareness and empathy. Imagine yourself as a musician collaborating in concert with other musicians. While you are playing your part, attuned to your own self, breathing purity of notes and musical intention, you are also intimately aware of and adjusting to the sounds, impulses, and intentions coming from the musicians around you. You're giving up your ego to align with a greater whole, becoming one, a single unit of multiple voices at one moment. I pray that we, as a community of faith, may stay attuned to each other and together bring forth a greater sense of at-one-ment in service to others. May it be so. Amen. Shalom, salam, namaste, and ashe.
And now, in setting an intention, may we remember our deep connection and belonging to each other in a spirit of at one moment, at one moment. And may we remember our deep connection to the earth and the music of the spheres. Let's take a few moments of silence for reflection in meditation, prayer, or in any way that is your practice. May it be so. And now I invite you to stand in body or spirit for our closing song, a closing hymn. I'm going to get that right someday. 298, Wake Now My Senses. And there are five verses.
Senses and hear the earth call, feel the deep power of being in all. Keep with the web of creation your vow, giving, receiving as love shows us how. Wake now, my reason, reach out to the
closing words. We hold you in our hearts as you go in this week, blessed and blessing the world. Go in peace, go in joy, go in love.
And now we will extinguish our chalice. And if you will join me in reading our extinguishing words, we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And now I invite you to rise again in body or spirit to sing our closing blessing song and enjoy the hand motions if you know them, or make them up if you like.
From you I receive, to you I give, together we share, and by this by this we live.
I want you to know that I was restraining myself greatly after that little step.